Part 3, Chapter 6 of Short History of the Christian Church by John Fletcher Hurst. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 6, Melanchthon and Other German Reformers. Philip Melanchthon. The friends and helpers of Luther came from every class. Of all these, Melanchthon was destined to be of most service, not only as an immediate co-laborer with Luther, but as a promoter of the general cause of Protestantism. He was born in Bretten, South Germany, in 1497, and was educated at Forsheim, Heidelberg, and Tübingen. When only 17 years of age, he became a professor in the Tübingen University, and began to attract attention by his remarkable knowledge of the classic writers. He edited Terence and other writers, and threw a new light upon both Greek and Roman writers. His fame spread abroad into other countries. Erasmus wrote of him the following: "What hopes may we not conceive of Philip Melanchthon, though as yet very young, almost a boy, he was only 18, but equally to be admired for his proficiency in both languages. What quickness of invention, what purity of diction, what vastness of memory, what variety of reading, what modesty and gracefulness of behavior, and what a princely mind." To Ecolampadius, the same man, Erasmus wrote, "Of Melanchthon I have already the highest opinion, and cherish the most magnificent hopes, so much so that I am persuaded Christ designs this youth to excel us all. He will totally eclipse Erasmus." He was called to Wittenberg as professor in 1518, and the same week began to lecture. He produced a profound impression immediately. Luther heard him and was charmed by him. A friendship immediately sprang up between them, which was never broken until death terminated the union of 28 years. The annals of literature and theology do not furnish a more beautiful illustration of the manner in which a great work can be performed by the combined action of two men than we find in the case of Luther and Melanchthon. There was no resemblance between them in quality of mind or temperament. The one thing which they had in common was the great cause of reform, and to that all other interests and gifts were made subordinate. The labors of Melanchthon were directed at once to the improvement of the methods of study in the university. His students increased rapidly, and soon rose to about 2,500. He insisted that the old scholastic philosophy was ridiculous, and consisted of terms rather than ideas. He urged the students to the fountainheads of truth, and placed before them the Bible as the only source of real knowledge. He then entered into the strife concerning indulgences, Luther going before him, and Melanchthon following closely with his philological lore, his fine logic, and his marvelous unfoldings of scriptural truth. The life of Melanchthon was now so thoroughly identified with that of Luther that it is difficult to separate the two. They lived in the same town, Wittenberg. They were in constant consultation, each doing what he was most able to do, and both working with unwearied zeal for the triumph of the cause to which they gave their lives. During Luther's stay in the Wartburg, Melanchthon was sorely grieved. He needed Luther's martial spirit, his strong will, his quick intuitions as to the best measures to win new victories. Hence he wrote such words as these: "I feel the need I have of good advice. Our Elijah is confined at a distance from us, though we are expecting and anticipating his return. What shall I say more? His absence absolutely torments me." On the other hand, Luther felt the need of Melanchthon's calm spirit, and, among many other words of the same character, he wrote from the Wartburg, "For the glory of the word of God, and the mutual consolation of myself and others, I would rather be consumed in a blazing fire than remain here half alive and utterly useless. If I perish, the prophet of Christ will not perish, and you, I hope, like another Elisha, will succeed Elijah." Luther, however, was sometimes out of patience with Melanchthon's great infirmity, despondency, and wrote him the following, in reply to Melanchthon's gloomy picture of the Protestant outlook. Let those who please talk against us, but why are we to be always looking on the dark side of things? Why not indulge hopes of better times? He compared Paul's appearance with Melanchthon's in the following words. Paul must have been an insignificant-looking person with no presence, a poor, dry little man, like Master Philip. While Luther was still in the Wartburg, he, nevertheless, longed for the society of his poor, dry little man, more than for all the robust men of the fatherland. So, when he returned to Wittenberg, and put the fanatics to shame and flight, he wrote with great joy to a relative, "I am in Amsdorf's house with my beloved friend Philip Melanchthon." Melanchthon's regularity in work was a marvel. He was seldom known to miss a lecture from any cause. On the day, in 1520, when he was married to Catherine Crappen, the burgomaster's daughter, he departed for once from his inflexible punctuality and posted on the roster the following release of his students from hearing him on Paul's epistle to the Romans. A studiis hodie facit oti gradia Philippus, nec nobis Pauli dogmata sacra legit. Rest from your studies, Philip says you may. We'll read no lectures on St. Paul today. Year after year passed by, and Melanchthon was always at his post, lecturing to the many students who had come from different countries to hear him. If, in the interests of the good cause of reform, he was absent for a day or two, he always returned to his post with renewed vigor. His lecture room was his throne. He was devoted to theological students and made them his trusted friends. In his last illness, he thought of them and wished, when too weak, to be dressed and deliver a lecture to them. He died in 1560. A short time before his death, he wrote his reasons why it is better for the Christian to die than to live, the column on the right containing the blessings gained by dying, and that on the left the evils avoided. Evils removed. You leave your sins. You are delivered from controversy and the rage of theologians. Advantages gained. You come to the light. You will see God. You will contemplate the Son of God. You will understand those wonderful mysteries which you cannot comprehend in this life, namely, why we are made as we are, and the union of the two natures in Christ. No man appreciated Melanchthon's character and work more highly than Luther. Of his theological commonplaces, Loci Theologicae, Luther said, "For theological study, it is the best book next to the Bible. Melanchthon has no ground for fear." Of Melanchthon's books, as a whole, he said, "I love his books better than my own. He ploughs and plants and sows and waters with joy, while I am only a coarse forester, digging up the roots and tearing out the thorns." Melanchthon was the theological builder for the German Reformation. He wrote the two symbols of the Lutheran Church, the Augsburg Confession, 1530, and the Apology for the Augsburg Confession, both admirable statements of doctrine, and he presented the so-called Saxon Confession, a declaration of the Protestant faith, to the Council of Trent, 1551. The friendship between Luther and Melanchthon, as a powerful factor towards the success of the Reformation, was only an illustration of a general fact. There were other attachments not less charming. The whole period of the planting of Protestantism abounds in remarkable adjustments and surrenders of individual tastes and capacities for the achievement of a great end. Each man was as necessary to the rest as their joint work was necessary to the success of the whole movement. It was a harmony of opposites, and as complete a providential blending of diverse natures as the world had seen since the days of the apostles. All temperaments and all classes of society were drawn upon to make the one harmonious picture of a young and vigorous Protestantism. Some of Luther's first and strongest friends were of the princely and noble class. Of the rulers, we count no less than six who were devoted friends of the new movement for the liberation of the conscience, and followed the leadership of Luther, namely, George, Maurice, Frederick the Wise, John, and John Frederick, all princes of Saxony, and Philip of Hesse. While enjoying the full confidence of these men, Luther never faltered in the assertion of personal independence. He never compromised a principle. In fact, he gained the confidence of the princes not merely by his valiant defense of the truth, but by his candor towards them. With the princes, we must not omit to join two fearless knights as friend of Protestantism, Ulrich von Hutten and Franz von Sickingen. These men offered Luther the use of their swords and a home in their castles, but he declined them both, saying that his was a spiritual conflict. In Luther's immediate circle, as co-workers with him, the scholars Justus Jonas, George Rohrer, Cruciger, Forster, and Bugenhagen stand next to Melanchthon. These men were mostly won to the cause of reform by the reading of Luther's writings, or the hearing of his lectures, or by his hymns, and, having once come within the charm of his person, became his willing cooperators in the various departments for which each was fitted. Bugenhagen was elected pastor in Wittenberg through Luther's influence, and was a powerful organizer of the new Protestant church in North Germany. Jonas was a professor in the university, and through his eloquence the city of Halle was led to adopt the Protestant cause. Lucas Cranach, the most celebrated German painter of his times, was an intimate friend of Luther, and through him we have accurate portraits of the parents, the entire family of Luther, and nearly all his friends and fellow workers. Cranach had a keen sense of the grotesque and satirical, and it was his pleasure to furnish woodcuts as adjuncts to Luther's stinging words against the abuses of the times. End of chapter 6.